Hello and welcome to Design Education Talks, the collaboration between New Art School and Design Didacts podcast. Our guest today is Sudebi Thakurata. Welcome, Sudebi.
Thank you, Lefteris, for inviting me and hosting me today.
It's a real pleasure
to be a part of this.
Yeah, it's a real pleasure to have you here today.
Yeah, same here. Really excited to seeing, you know, like what unfolds today.
Fantastic, fantastic. So tell us about you and your work.
Yeah, thank you. I think, I love telling stories and listening to stories. So someone the other day, I was a panel, panelist in a conference, rather a festival in Pakistan. And one of my co-panelists, she just wrote back to me saying that, oh, I loved your description on Instagram. I'm not a very social media savvy person. I mean, off and on, I use it. So one of the first things that I use to describe myself on Instagram is I'm an awestruck traveler. And I think that's something that's very me. Why? Because I feel like travel is a very important aspect of my life. It's a very important component of my life, even as a design educator. And when I mean travel, I don't just talk about traveling outside, but traveling inside as well. And I use the adjective awestruck because I think that's quintessential me. I'm mostly awestruck. You know, it's very hard to bore me. I find everything so exciting. I sort of interconnect different elements, and the world is such an amazing treasure trove for me to discover new things about old and old things about the new. So I feel like that's very me. Having said that, I feel like journey has always been my calling, you know, and while traveling in whichever way I do, I like connecting dots and seeing something much larger as the whole than the parts of it. And I realized that, you know, I learn the most through my interactions with people and places, my encounters with different kinds of perspectives and ways of seeing, and my passion for locating possibilities for learning. And I design learning, emphasizing on place-based, context-specific, people-centric, eco-centric, socially, environmentally, and culturally relevant issues. And while doing that, I try to integrate different perspectives and aesthetics. I also love delving into the process of facilitation amongst groups of people with diverse and even contrasting points of view. So I would say that facilitation to me is a really deep experiential and embodied process of self-discovery while navigating amongst the overlapping acts of curation, mediation, design, storytelling, visualizing, enabling, mapping, interconnections, etc. And I feel that it's both a humbling and empowering process that makes me know myself better in the process of knowing the others. That's the bigger aspect of what I do, why I do what I do. But I have been teaching at one of the oldest design schools in India for the last 11 years. It's Srishti Manipal Institute of Art, Design and Technology. It's 4.5 years that I also have co-founded a design-led collective along with my partner, Probal Banerjee. It's called The Epicenter. We do a lot of work in India, in Southeast and South Asia, and of course, globally. So, I mean, I'm sure through this podcast, I'll be revealing more about myself.
That's very interesting. Tell us about your travels inside.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. So I feel like, So this is again another interesting thing. So last year, around this time, in the month of March, I remember, the world was very different, as you know, right? And beginning of the month of March, I was invited to the Philippines for a British Council-led conference. It was called Making Futures. So a lot of my work is around the notion of futures and how can we be guided by the futures as opposed to being guided by the past, And it was an amazing experience that I had over there. And I co-facilitate a culture leadership program across Southeast Asia. And it's the third year of that. And it, until last year, March, it enabled me to travel to 3 to 4 countries every year, you know. And apart from that, there were many other kinds of work that I used to do, which would enable me to travel within India, outside India, and all of that. So when the pandemic hit us hard and the lockdown started happening, and I definitely had an initial reaction of feeling almost claustrophobic, because I think my biggest worry was the fact that I will not be able to travel and interact with people. And at that point in time, I was not a big believer of online facilitation either. But I felt that it really enabled me to travel within even more, because, you know, as I design experience and interweave narratives, I mean, I like calling myself a narrative designer. I also make people think and reflect and give shape to their thoughts by making them visible. And in that process, I sculpt out meaning from the different conversations, observations, and communication. And I feel like the fact that I experience and want others to experience, you know, wish to make the invisible visible. And the fact that I think of the world as a treasure trove of narratives and want to create dialogues and foster a safe, empathetic, inclusive environment which can nurture discourses, it kind of makes me a meta curator of various processes as a facilitator. And these intersections that I sort of see are the travels that I actually embark upon. Mm-hmm. The fact that there are multiple perspectives which might be not just different from mine, but it can be contrasting, it can be contradictory. And the fact that, you know, there is a whole spectrum of thoughts, feelings, emotions, being, and I am a little part of that, that makes me very humble and very curious to kind of discover other perspectives. And this act of discovering the world while discovering myself is the travel that I embark upon.
Very good. Very good. Fantastic. So tell us about the project you're involved currently, about your work and your research endeavors.
Right. So I am one of those people, you know, someone, one of my friends, she told me once that you are a very interesting character, because you will generally find people who either, like, you know, their work is very wide and they don't get into the depth of things, or there are people who are specialists who will go into one particular thing really well. I think I'm more like, you know, what they call as a T-shaped individual. It's like the wider I go, the deeper I become, the deeper I go, the wider I go, you know. So I think it's this kind of a interconnected way and interdependent way of seeing the world and making sense of things makes me who I am. Now, why I'm talking about this is, at any given point in time, pre-COVID, during COVID, and I'm hoping later on also there will be a time post-COVID, I continue to do work in different realms, and that's by choice. It's not because I'm confused, but I think I gain my own clarity by being in different spaces.
Absolutely.
So I'll give a few examples of the kind of work that I've been doing. So at Srishti, where I teach, as I told you, and I absolutely enjoy teaching as an experience, I have been recently teaching a course in foundation with one of my co-facilitators around the notion of spaces and places, and the sub-theme of that is lived, perceived, and conceived. And what I'm trying to do in that course is, this May, coming May, is the birth centenary of a very famous filmmaker of India. His name is Satyajit Ray. We are trying to delve deeper into the kind of work that he has done, his films, his body of work, his writing, his illustration, his music, and all of that, and trying to understand notions of spaces and places through that. So that's one of the pieces of work that I'm doing. On the other hand, I'm currently working on a workshop that I'm co-teaching with a colleague of mine, which is about mapping food systems and understanding context and people and culture and politics through that kinds of mapping. That's about the design-based courses. On the other hand, I'm co-facilitating a global studio with my collaborators from University of Michigan Stamp School of Design, another person from National Institute of Design India, and Virginia Commonwealth University in Qatar. And we have about 60 students globally across three different countries. And we are trying to see how students from India, US, and Qatar, you know, they can come together and make sense of this kind of an online environment, which is quite difficult for design and art education, as you know. I mean, how do they make sense of the current world? So that's one of the projects I'm teaching. I'm also co-facilitating this cultural leadership program across Southeast Asia. This time it has become online, but the challenge therefore is, how do you translate or redesign or reimagine an erstwhile program which was completely dependent on experiential learning? Mm-hmm. which you're delivering online, enabling people to get into an act of creative collaborations again without meeting each other? And how do you design those processes? And these are people who are at a mid-senior level. They are artists, designers, cultural leaders, and all of that. Like a few other projects that I'm currently working on, I mean, at the Epicenter, there is one project where we are trying to work around the notion of designing future consciousness, future literacy, fluency, and competency. And we are trying to do this with especially people from the grassroots level, whereas there's yet another response that we had had about the pandemic, which is called the Musical Manifesto Project. And as a part of that, we are working on designing what we call as a dignity bank. You know, I mean, if as human beings, we can think about being able to articulate what dignity means for us, how would we shape our lives, and what role can design play in something like that? So these are some of the projects, but of course, there are many more. We are currently also working with a startup, you know, from the conception to execution of a social commerce site using design-led innovation processes. And yes, I mean, I would say that a lot of our work actually is in the area of designing impact, whether at a social level, cultural level, economic level, or at a level of business. So, yeah.
Wow, that's a lot of work. That's a serious some serious projects. So how did you get into teaching?
I think you will probably laugh if I tell you, I think as much as I remember my life, I have always taught. So, I mean, I think maybe I can remember when I was 3-year-old, 4-year-old, when I was in Montessori, even then I used to teach because I think teaching was an act of sense making for me. So, you know, what I used to do, I would imagine students in front of me, even when I was a child, and I have been learning music since my childhood. So whether it was teaching music, teaching any form of art, it was a maths class or an English class or a history class, didn't matter. I would come back home. I would imagine there are other people, something that I would not like my teacher, you know, in terms of how she or he has delivered. I would actually design possibilities of teaching that better. And I felt like, you know, when you teach, you actually learn something much better. So that's how early I started teaching. And I mean, I think most of my friends would remember me as someone they would always come to. In fact, my teachers in school and in college and later, like if someone needed help, they would always ask me to go and teach. So why I'm telling this is that I think teaching, and I mean, I use the word facilitation more than teaching. I think design and facilitation, juxtaposing the two is really something that I find fascinating, because to me, design, any kind of design for that matter, is an act of facilitation, and facilitation is an act of design. So yeah, I mean, that's how I had gotten into teaching. But on another note, I think I kind of got into Srishti, as I told you, 11 years back. But before that, I was a part of a fellowship program that I had got. It was called Sir Ratan Tata Trust Fellowship. I, in fact, got another video blogging fellowship. I was working in the social impact spaces in understanding how can one use critical media literacy as a life skill. And that process enabled me to travel to a lot of unexplored corners of India, you know. And I started realizing that a lot of people, they have the intention to do work in social spaces, but then they talk about active citizenships and other things. And all of these things, in a way, become a project. And for me, life is a project in itself. And I felt that it's through teaching that one can embed in all these different elements in a much more holistic, much more systemic, much more realistic ways. And then it doesn't matter what you become, you enable different kinds of learners to make their own choices. And I feel as teachers, that's what we do. We help people design choices using different kinds of processes. And it's not for me to create the choices for them. The choices are to be shaped by them. But the fact that you can do that, and in that process, I sharpen and deepen and thicken and widen my ways of designing choices, I feel gives me a real high.
Fantastic. Fantastic. That's really interesting. What are the greatest challenges you faced, both pre-COVID and right now?
You know, I feel one of the things is that I feel that a lot of people, and I'm not just talking about the world of design, people are so impatient. You know, we are so much in a hurry that we don't give enough time to understanding something. Forget about doing that. So I feel like one of the things is that we do not know how to pause and how to use a pause in a meaningful way. The fact that in order to find meaning and create meaning, you need to take a pause. We don't understand that. Secondly, I feel another challenge I find in a lot of people and processes is that we are, we use big words like colonization, and we talk about decolonization and all of those things, but our minds are so colonized in a larger way that we convert a creative, so-called creative process into something very uniform, very factory-like. So everything starts looking the same. So you're uniformly unique. And I feel that we do not know how to be what I would love to call as a cosmopolitan local. You know, the fact that you don't lose sight of the larger world, the globe, but at the same time, understanding what the local is and remaining that cosmopolitan local so that you neither become very narrowly hyper-nationalistic or, you know, constantly talking about everything that I have is good in a very us versus them way, but nor is it about being swayed by everything that's from the outside is good, you know, without using your own critical lens to kind of unpack it and see what's good and what's not. So that's another challenge I feel. The other challenge I feel a lot of people do is we grew up being big reductionists in our ways of understanding anything. And this process of trying to make everything oversimplified, not simple, but simplistic, makes us create more complications because we don't understand how to delve into uncertainties, how to be okay with complexities and ambiguities, right? So, I love stories, as I told you. So there's one story that I love, and I feel like that story is true for everybody, including myself, that it says that there was a student who went to a Zen master, and he had been following the Zen master for a long, long time. And he, after following lots of lectures of the master, said, I don't just understand. Could you just please put all that you have been talking about in a nutshell? Can you reduce or, you know, talk about Buddhism in one phrase? So everyone started laughing. I mean, how can you really talk about Buddhism in one phrase? And then the master said, everything changes. Okay. And I feel like these two phrases, everything changes, or this statement, is something which we don't understand. Okay. We talk about it. We will talk about a VUCA world, which is volatile, uncertain, complex, ambiguous, etc. We know that everything changes. We change. Everything changes. The world changes. And yet we have this whole obsession about creating change, right? So you try to create change, or you try to design change in a changing world. What does that even mean? You know, that there's a fallacy in that entire process, right? And I feel that the fact that we are not humble enough to recognize that everything changes creates a huge problem in all our world, in all our work. And it therefore creates this whole dominance of binary narratives, you know, like either good or bad. This is right, that is wrong. And we constantly are breaking and dividing the world rather than connecting and reconnecting. So I feel like these are some of the biggest challenges that I find in not just design, yeah, anything.
Shall we create stillness instead of change?
Yes, I feel so. I mean, if I don't have the stillness to recognize everything changes, how am I going to create any change? You know?
Fantastic. Yes, absolutely. I was also referring to some of the challenges that were like more specific to your school, like right now and sort of, yeah. You know, but more importantly, right now.
I would say I was explaining that in the last 1 year, we have primarily been online with certain parts happening offline. I feel that, there are different kinds of challenges. One kind of challenges that I feel is for people like students who have seen the or who have felt the actual essence of design education, and suddenly it has all become online. They don't feel the human touch. They have different kinds of problems around technology and many other things, you know, that feeling of disconnect is there. The other kind of challenges that you would find is where people like foundation year students who have never really seen or like sort of perceived how an actual design education works, their journey into design education has started being online, right? So connecting them and creating a community of practitioners from and of them is another challenge. But I think, Leftris, one of the challenges that we don't talk about, and I think I'll be able to talk about it not just by virtue of being an educator in my school, but because I do so many global programs, is I think we haven't spent enough time as designers and as design educators in understanding ourselves. Why I'm saying this is that we do talk about empathy. I don't see much of empathy towards ourselves, towards other people, to recognize that, you know, people are having lots of problems, some of which is invisible, some of which is unheard of, some of which are difficult to even perceive. And we can be a little less harsh on ourselves. So, you know, it's almost like trying to say that everything is normal. I'm just going to try and do everything how I earlier would have done. And without acknowledging this changing nature of the context, when we try to do something, it creates a kind of disruption which is not very creative. It's a disruption that destructs. And I feel that, I mean, this is a question that I've posed to a lot of people, that have we as designers and design practitioners and design educators, are we being like people who are creatively responding to the pandemic, or we are reacting to the pandemic and making it into a chore? So and I'm not blaming anybody. I'm not blaming the systems either. I'm saying this is where we are. I haven't quite seen very many creative, forget about solutions, but at least approaches to really kind of address it. Because there are so many assumptions, you know, like I think I have unlearned that if you are in a classroom where lots of people do not want to turn on their videos, the general perception is they're not connecting. Not really. I have seen people who, for whatever reason it is, they do not want to turn on the videos, but they're very actively engaged in the classroom. Whereas there have been situations where you would see a lot of faces right there in front of the cameras, things being recorded and all, and they're physically there and mentally not there at all, you know? So I think that we have our own assumptions and perceptions and preconceived notions about others. And the more we try and look at it from an empathetic, inclusive eyes, try and understand what kind of vulnerabilities do people have, and be okay about our own vulnerabilities. I feel, you know, we grow up in systems which are so unkind that you are scared to show that you're vulnerable.
Yeah.
But I feel a kind and an inclusive and an equitable system is such where you should be okay with your vulnerabilities, because that's the most authentic self that Absolutely. You are projecting to someone, right?
Wow.
And I have realized, Leftris, that if you're okay to be vulnerable in front of our students, they also have kinder responses to you, as opposed to trying and seeing that, oh, there is a hierarchy that this person has to be very strong and a Mr. or Mrs. Know-it-all. You know, I don't have to know it all. I'm okay not knowing anything. So it's okay.
Absolutely. That's fantastic. That's fantastic. So with this very good lens, what would you do, like, if you could do anything to change things? How would you do design education differently?
I feel like, I keep using metaphors. So I'm just thinking about a particular statement or a provocation, which I really love. A lot of people use it. It's, I think, another Sufi saying. And it says that you think just because you understand one, that you must therefore understand two, because one and one make two. But you forget that you must also understand the and. I feel that's where we are. We are so narrowly obsessed and focused on trying to either understand the one and the one and the two, or the fact that, oh, I already know it, so what's there? There's nothing new to sort of unfold or understand. Understanding these ands are really, really important. And as I said, that I feel that if we try and broaden the notion of what is design, who is a real designer in today's world? I mean, if we start looking at design as an act of facilitation, which then means that you will start not focusing on what you learned as design while you were a student or while you developed your practice, you would start understanding design from a futuristic lens. And at the same time, as design educators, if we start using design principles in the act of designing learning, I feel that a lot of things change. Because at the end of the day, how are we creative practitioners if we constantly reduce ourselves to content providers? That, oh, my role as a teacher is to actually provide content. The content is creative, fine. But then I'm doing it in a really boring, matter-of-factly way. If I use design principles in it, start understanding our students as users of our learning design processes, and then start looking at their environment, their context, I feel like a lot of changes will automatically happen. But having said that, I feel design is transdisciplinary. That's how I understand design. Not going into the jargon of the word trans, multi, inter, and all, truly, I feel that we need to come together and understand many other people in these processes. We should try and think about ways in which we can design more inclusive systems around us. Because unless and until certain things change at a systemic level, mindsets change, behaviors change, I don't think we can make bigger transformations, you know. We can bring in shifts. We can work in small pockets and be happy with those. Because I feel like leftists, this is another thing that I noticed, that we as design educators often knowingly, unknowingly, intentionally, or I don't know, we like to stay in our own bubbles, but it's time to burst those bubbles and see how many other intersections can come in. You know, like the world is our classroom. Mm-hmm. The world is a treasure trove. Why can't we design for the world, with the world, you know?
Absolutely, absolutely. But what about those more practical aspects of design that, as you said, take a long time to develop?
I feel like so one of the things, I mean, I can speak for India as a country, as I see, you know, there's a change, perceptible change that I would say I have seen. About a decade ago, you would find a lot of people coming to design schools. And I'm not talking about a time when there were too many design schools in India. There were hardly a few. Yeah. They literally had to fight with their family members to embark upon a journey into design, because either people did not know what design was, or they thought design was either interior design or fashion design, at the most graphic design. They wouldn't understand it, right? So convincing the parents was a difficult thing. While today, if you look at it, we very often interact with students who would say that they have been forced to get enrolled in a design school, and design schools are mushrooming everywhere because parents think that UI and UX design is the new normal. And it's, you know, in India, some of us make fun of it, that it's like the, like when we were growing up, we were in college, getting an IT job, was, getting a design job is the new IT in India, right? So the moment you get into that mode, people go to design coaching classes. They don't want to understand it for what it is, you know. Yeah. They want a quick solution, a quick fix. They want templates. Yeah. And imagine the fallacy of templatizing design. I mean, I rest my case there when design is templatized. So I feel like we need to change that.
Okay, that's very, but how do we change that?
I feel the change comes from us, you know, and as practitioners, and as I, like I'm saying that I believe that at least my work, you know, I have not been, I mean, I have been a designer by practice, not by training, right? And the fact that, you know, a place like India, where you will on one hand find a lot of people who might not have so-called training in design, but they're real designers. Then there are other people who are trained, but absolutely have no creativity, you know. I mean, I embark upon lots of journeys where I see people who call themselves as creative practitioners, but they have no imagination. And people who are working in non-imaginative spaces who are very, very creative, right? I feel that breaking these binaries for ourselves, we being open to learning, not just from books, but looking at the world as a textbook. You know, I love using a term called place as text or perspectives as text. So for example, I had started an initiative a few years back, and it's called the Archival City. So Archival City is basically an initiative where we say that the city, and the city is here a metaphor of any place for that matter, saying that the city is basically an archive. Mm-hmm. It is waiting to be unfolded. It's waiting to be unearthed. The more you delve deeper into the places and the people, understand people's perspectives, the more you'll be perceptive to how people are. How do they think? How do they feel? What do they like? What do they not like? And how do they make sense of the world, right? Now, this might sound very fundamental and like obvious and say, oh, what is so great about it? I feel that we need to see how we can expand our own practices as design educators. Mm-hmm. Because only when we engage in these contexts, only when we challenge ourselves, will we understand the challenge that a learner in today's world actually has. Not really depend on what you had learned in a design school 20 years back. You need to look at what is required, which might mean that it can challenge everything that you knew until now. Mm-hmm. And it's okay to understand and realize that. And I think the moment we can feel confident about our ability to learn and self-learn, a lot of insecurities go. Mm-hmm. The moment mm-hmm. our confidence is built on the foundations of which school I went to, how many projects I have done, you know, what I have learned, how many books I have read, and all these textual theoretical knowledge, I feel that it makes us very insecure. Because one day, if those things are taken away from you, and a real uncertain world unfurls in front of you, you don't know what to do there, right? So I feel like we need to challenge ourselves as practitioners. Mm-hmm. We need to start being learners. We need to start like making these connections and looking at the world with many centers where there's no one center of knowledge and wisdom, but many, many, many different centers of knowledge and wisdom, and really believe in experiential perspectives and learning. I feel that it takes away from a lot of pressure. And I feel that the moment we can really do this in action, the relationship that we start fostering with our students change. And I'm seeing this with my own examples, with my own life. Many of my students, like past and present, they just become friends with me. And I'm not saying friends in the sense that we are going for a party together. No, not that kind of friendship. I'm talking about a friendship where we can exchange. We can exchange our dialogues. We can exchange our dilemmas. We are co-travelers in this journey of discovering new things. Because, like, let me give an example, right? The fact that during the pandemic, me and one of my students, like all my students, are having to face the difficulty of an online education, in a way, bring us closer. I feel that's not a divider. It's a connector. So it's our perspective through which we are looking at it, right? Like on one hand, we can say, oh, I need to perform. Like teaching is a performance and I am at this higher pedestal and I need to be always all right. But I look at it the other way around that, oh, where I am, my students are also there. They're having problems, I'm having problems. So if I actually co-design this experience, they will be much more engaged. I will be much more engaged and both of us will have some kind of learning from it. And, you know, we can actually be friends in that process. So I feel like that's my take. And I have really like consciously practiced it in the last 1 year.
Fantastic. Fantastic. How can our viewers best find you?
So as I said that I have like a little bit of social media presence. I'm on Instagram. I'm on Facebook and on LinkedIn. So maybe in the notes, I will be sharing the handles. And I would also say that a lot of my work will be found at DEP Center. So it is DEPICENTRE, DEP Center. That's the design collective that Prabal and me, both of us had co-founded. We are on Instagram and on LinkedIn. And if you follow us, that'll be great. And just to kind of let you know, Leftaris, I haven't shared this anywhere as of now. So this year, September, we are turning 5. At the epicenter. So we are planning to come up with an interesting whole range of different narratives that we want to share with people of our learnings and unlearnings. And on that occasion, we are just about to start our new blog. We are starting to make some new publications. And these publications are not deliberately things which are theoretical, but real experiences, unfurling learnings, and what are we learning through these processes. So stories of real ordinary people who can help us design better.
That's really exciting. That's very exciting, Sudebi. What is the advice you'd like to leave us with?
I feel that I would say be kind. Mm-hmm. Be kind to yourself, be kind to the world, be kind to your own practice. I feel that, if we can do this, that's fantastic. Because kindness is something which really help us connecting and reconnecting. So, yeah.
Fantastic, fantastic. Well, this has been a wonderful conversation. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
And hopefully we'll connect again really, really soon.
Yeah.
All the best. Have a fantastic day.
Bye. Bye-bye. You too.